आप बताइए।
With a warm greetings, I extend my warmest welcome to the talk show Education 4.0 for Safe, Sustainable Societies. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the talk show organized by Samurja Educational Society on the theme Education 4.0 for Safe Sustainable Societies. We appreciate and applaud everyone, our panelists and participants, for the zeal to share and passion to learn with Samurja. Samurja means the sum of creative energies. Here is a small video about Samurja.
Samurja Educational Society, established in the year 1991, has completed its gratifying journey of three decades. The society was conceptualized with the objective of educating children and preparing them to be morally upright and vocationally independent. Ever since its inception, the society has continued to take tiny steps forward, redesigning the educational fabric in all possible ways through various educational activities, besides conducting social outreach programs like the Girl Next Door and the Charity Walk. Samurja is constantly striving to bring together some of the most ignited minds in the field of education to introduce change in the educational fabric of the nation by providing educational vision, empowering educators, inspiring learners, and elevating various organizations through training sessions, panel discussions, talk shows, conferences, and symposiums. The society has also conceptualized and published periodicals and magazines for students and teachers. Samurja continues to explore new domains, trends and landscapes to enrich the educators across the country by equipping them to resolve the academic challenges in their classroom to make teaching and learning more joyous and engaging. It also helps educators realize their vision and collaborate with national and international educators to have sustainable societies and a happy nation, thus redefining the paradigms of Indian education. Jai Hind, Namaskar.
Once again, welcome to another episode of series Experion Talk Show. In the previous session, we analyzed that happiness is the ultimate purpose of human creation. It is an unabridged aim of human existence. Our resource speaker, Mrs. Neeta Rastogi, beautifully shared how study of bio, that is study of life, in various domains like medicines, culture, agriculture, biotechnology, biochemistry, is important to be rational, balanced, and happy in life. As a teacher, our lesson planning and assessment must ensure that our children are engaged and they are constantly upskilled. The need is to realize that we study, we learn, not only to earn, compete, to become ahead of others, but also to care, share, collaborate, and evolve together. I have become my own version of optimism. If I cannot make into through one gate, I go through another gate. And if I cannot go through the other gate, I'll make a gate. Something terrific should come out of me, no matter how dark is the room, said Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore. I'm not an economist, but I do hold a degree in economics. And this degree has helped me in better planning to make informed decisions, besides being a little more analytic to manage things better at personal and professional front. My objective is to optimize the outcome, be it cooking in the kitchen or organizing an international conference. The words like opportunity, opportunity cost, scarcity, cost of living index, equilibrium, have become a part of my vocabulary. Economics actually influences everyday life. And we understood the difference between increase in demand and expansion in demand. The ability to solve problems such as financial investment, understanding the relation between demand and supply, role of opportunities, reasons for inflation, better public policies for economic growth, analyzing the distribution of income across individuals, regions, and countries, and the causes of those differences are all covered under the domain of economics. Making policy to forecasting decision within our homes, organization, or by government, impacting business or industry are impossible without the fair knowledge of economics. It helps us understand how a small financial shock might be propagated nationwide or even globally, exactly like Corona. One of the well-formulated studies of Fortune 500 companies, 401k saving plan, found that switching to automatic enrollment increase employees' participations from 49% to 86% across the globe. I'll pause myself here and would know more about the latest changes in the concepts, pedagogy, and the assessment as per CBSE aligned with NEP 2020 from our guest, Mr. Puneet Dugal, Headmaster, Elcon International School. I request Puneet ji to kindly extend the verbal greetings to our participants.
Good evening, ma'am. Good evening, all the participants. Yeah.
Thank you so much. I'll request Monica ma'am to please welcome our guest with a musical note and introduce him.
तो सीबीएसई का ये नया पैटर्न है, इसके लिए कहीं पर किसी भी स्टेज पे मैं ये चाहूंगा कि तुम इसको लेके बहुत एक लाइट मत हो जाना या इसको बहुत इजी मत लेने लग जाना, क्योंकि जब जब ऑब्जेक्टिव पेपर्स हुए आपको पता है कि सीधा मार्क या तो वन होते हैं या जीरो होते हैं। मतलब अगर मैं बात करूं एक सब्जेक्टिव पेपर की और एक सिक्स मार्कर की, तो वहां पे फिर भी स्कोप होता है कि तुमने लिखा है तो तुम्हें 5 मिल जाएंगे या 4.5 मिल जाएंगे या 5.5 मिल जाएंगे, बट यहाँ पे तो 1 में से 0 हो जाएगा। और अगर ऐसे 5-6 क्वेश्चन गलत हो गए तो पूरा का पूरा तुम्हारा रिजल्ट खराब हो जाएगा। सो इसको लेके जो मल्टीपल चॉइस क्वेश्चंस हैं वो तो आई थिंक वही ओल्ड और ट्रेडिशनल अप्रोच है, बट मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि मल्टीपल चॉइस क्वेश्चंस भी आज की तारीख में यू हैव टू बी वेरी वेरी क्लियर, और वो तभी क्लियर हो पाओगे जब तुम्हारे कॉन्सेप्ट्स क्लियर होंगे। ठीक है, तो अभी जब
Welcome Puneet ji, this is your YouTube channel, and the credit goes to Kriti. She has she found the things and she thought that she must put it. It's really great. We also have with us our mentor Dr. Ashok Pandey, director Elcon Group of Schools, the most popular leader and a blessing to Samuja. And from the last 2 days I am getting so much messages and you can say the feedback that how sir has taken Samuja to a different platform. Thank you, Ashok sir. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. I admire your ability to give credit to others, which solely belongs to you. Thank you. Thank you.
Welcome, sir. Another charismatic leader, our mentor, Dr. Rajesh Hasija, director in the Prastha Group of Schools, a leader par excellence, a multitasker, and a high. Welcome,
sir. Privileged to be part of this talk show. I really learn every week something new. So thank you. Eager to listen to Puneet.
See, still you are multitasking. On the wheel, still you are learning. Thank you. Thank you so much. So without further delay, I'll request Puneet ji to please share with us what are the new changes in the concepts, what new pedagogies you are following to make the learning of in economics being more impactful, and what are the changes in the assessment pattern. Over to Puneet.
Thank you, Mukta ma'am, and good evening once again. To you, to Dr. Ashok Pandey, the director, sir, Dr. Rajesh Hasija ji, and the team from Samurja, and all the participants. I'm sure each one of you is going to learn something new today. I am going to learn something new today, as Dr. Rajesh Hasija sir was speaking. And I'm very impressed by Kriti, the way you have gathered so much information about me. So I was just smiling and looking at the presentation. Maybe it is someone who is me. And I really like Mukta ma'am, you talking about a lot about me, that how you still remember me as that kid who just entered the field of education 15, 16 years back. And I think I'll give credit to all my guides, mentors, my principal sir, director sir, all the teachers, you people. So let me share my screen. Let us begin with this talk show. And I'll request everyone to be very interactive. You can write in the chat box. You can continue to ask questions whenever you have that opportunity. So I'm just sharing my screen. So Monica ma'am, is this visible? Okay, thank you. So I first of all, let me tell you, ma'am, I really liked your this Experian Economics. Means this is a very, very beautiful name. And I also like this entire concept of pedagogy assessment concepts for safe, sustainable societies. Now, can we imagine a safe and sustainable society without economics? I think most of the participants are from economics background. So I'll be a little biased also for economics, that yes, we cannot think about a sustainable society without economics. So once again, good evening, everyone, and let us begin. Now, when you talk about a new idea, I think new idea comes when we talk to each other, listen to each other, and speak to each other. And there are many, many ideas which are evolving. And I think in past 4-5 years, we have seen phenomenal ideas coming up, shaping up, and implementation being done at various schools, be it an urban school or even a rural school in India. Now, very quickly, I know all the participants, you know many vocabulary of economics, but I really want you to write in the chat box as to what you are feeling right now. I know most of you might be teachers and the online school, the offline school, dead tired, and 5 o'clock, the evening time, your tea time, and someone has come and really bombarded you with a lot of economics. So that is not going to happen, let me tell you. So any one word which is coming to your mind right now, which talks about that, what you are feeling right now at 4 p.m., 4:15 p.m., 21st September, anything. Any word you can write in the chat box, and I'll be just going through your own energetic, oh my God, interesting, economy of scale, oh my God. Can we have some words without economics? I know all of you love economics. So consumer equilibrium, oh my God. So inquisitive, yeah, economies. So great, I think. Can we have something funny, non-economics? Can we think something which, oh great, distribution. So great, I think most of you are feeling that energetic, and I want you to be comfortable. You can have your cup of tea while you're listening to me and you're going to discuss. So thank you everyone for your inputs. I'll move forward now. When I got this invitation by ma'am that you have to talk about the concept, the pedagogy, the assessment, the first thing I think when we discuss with our colleagues, our teachers, our students is learning for life. Means when you talk about economics, you talk about any subject, school education, we talk that learning is for life. Learning, whether it is concept, whether it is pedagogy, whether it is assessment, I think if we all connected with learning for life, I think our work will be very easy and simple, and these difficult terminologies are not going to affect us. So let us focus on this term, learning for life. Now, if I use this term, learning for life, I use this term a lot with my students, with my colleagues in my institution, and where we talk about that, can we actually create a system where a lifelong learning can take place? I'm sure all the participants also do the same in their own institutions, wherever they are working. Now, one question which always comes to my mind when I go to a classroom, whether it is virtual or offline or online, what do we really want to achieve by teaching economics to our students? What is my target? What I really want to achieve? If I go to a classroom today, or in the morning, if I've taken a virtual class or an offline class, what is my goal? What is my target? And what kind of student I want once that student passes out grade 11 or passes out grade 12 and gets into a college or a university? So can we imagine that kind of a student in our life? So I think as teachers, as educators, we have to first visualize as to what kind of product in terms of economics, if I use the product, the term product or the total product, as to what kind of output is going to come. Because the input is going to come from us, and the output will be these young students who will get into colleges, universities, employment, jobs, businesses, everywhere you'll find these students in next 4-5 years. Now, moving further, when I ask this question to myself in my own classroom, I first ask myself whether I'm going to focus on the mastery of the subject or marks. Now, this is a very, very difficult question to answer. Let me be very, very honest with you. Because if I go for mastery, does that mean that few marks will be deducted? Or if I go for marks, will mastery be at a minus level? So we have heard a lot of graphs and histograms and the x-axis and the negative side. So I'm sure you can imagine that dilemma is always there in a teacher's mind, and an economics teacher who is getting into a class, that do I have that pressure of the school management or principal to get how many 90s you have got? How many students have got 100? So that pressure always remains. But can I actually forget the mastery while going into my classroom? Now, the second question I ask myself when I go into a classroom, that is it going to be a joy or a stress, both for me as well as my students? So if as a teacher, I'm very stressed out and the entire focus is on completing the syllabus, the PT1, the midterm, the pre-board, the board. So that stress I'm going to pass on to my students. So let us focus on being very joyful. Can I enter my classroom with a packet of Maggi in my hand? Can I enter my classroom with a 2-liter Coke bottle and few glasses and tell my students, oh my God, who is going to, who really wants this cold drink? Who really wants to have this Maggi? And who really wants to have this chocolate? To be very honest, I have gone. I have did that with my students sometimes. And this is something.
Thank you for a while. Monica, ma'am, there is a message that the joining link is not working. Kindly see to it and post it on the WhatsApp group. Thank you. Please continue, Puninji.
So I have tried this out and still I have those feedback of students and they're going to say that, oh my God, Puneet sir is going to enter with a cold drink or a Maggi packet or a biscuit packet or a chocolate. So let us be very joyful inside our classrooms. There is, I think, everything can easily be taught with a smile on our faces. And the third question I ask myself is that, again, I'll repeat myself, learning for life or learning for exams? I know exams are very important. Dr. Mukta Mishra was talking about an exam which I gave in 2007. So how can I deny that marks, that these exams are not important because it gave me that medal? But yes, simultaneously, it is our responsibility as educators and teachers that we prepare our students for life also. So it is not something that we can ignore marks. I'm not saying that. But yes, within the current scenario, within the curriculum framework, within the textbooks, whatever CBSE curriculum is there, or going a little bit beyond books, I think we can talk about learning for life also with our students. So let us see. Now, if I look at that traditional approach, and it is something which I'm going, speaking with my own experience, when I was a very, very young teacher at the age of 24, 25, I entered into school education teaching in 2005. And the traditional approach was also always there. NCERT is very important. Read from my notes. Open your book and page number this, and this question is going to come in board exam. You just meet me after the board exam and you will see that question paper at 1:30 p.m. And once you move out from the board center, you'll see this question will come, the expected question. I think this approach, I think we all have grown with this approach. I have myself grown as a student also, and even as a teacher also, I must admit. But can we actually think beyond? So we are here to break those shackles today. Can we think beyond something? I'm not saying that we'll have to completely switch off, but yes, there are alternatives available right now, which I'm going to talk about. I really like this quote by John Dewey. I think I've every time used in my presentations, whenever I've discussed the issue with teachers, that if we teach today's students as we taught yesterday's, I think we rob them of tomorrow. This is something I've learned from my institution, Alcon International School. I cannot teach the way I've taught my student in last year. So if I joined the school in the year 2006, in 2007, my strategy was different. 2008, it was different. And I'm sure this is the same experience all of you have. So we keep on changing. We keep on learning from each other, adapting. And I think this session organized by Samurja Group is all about this only, that we learn from each other, we talk to each other, and engage in some kind of a collaboration where we move forward. Next, I really like a TED talk. Monica ma'am is here, my director sir is here, and it has happened to me practically that let us begin from zero. Let us put aside everything on one go. I really like the quote said by Mahatma Gandhiji that let us reduce ourselves to zero. If we really want to do something, I think the first thing is we will have to have a blank slate, a clean slate, and let us keep everything aside and begin from zero. And then I think we can have a fresh perspective and a fresh look. So let us begin from zero. I think that can actually change the life of a student, the life of a teacher, the life of an educator. And everyone will agree with me, the pandemic in 2020, March and April, if I talk about the online school system, I think we all have started from zero. I'm not going to talk about this. But I think we all know how to move from zero once again. And people in their businesses and economics, we have seen a lot of things that happened. Business have collapsed. People have changed jobs. Lot many things have happened. So we have to prepare our students to actually start thinking on these lines. And if we have to prepare our students first, I think we will have to prepare ourselves that, yes, am I ready to actually begin from zero? Now, let us talk about few ideas which have been implemented and which can easily be implemented. It is not difficult. Can I really make my student a celebrity? Can we organize a webinar with the help of students where students are panelists and we are audience? As teachers, are we actually willing to listen to our students? Because when we go into a classroom and we talk about those 40, 45 minutes and keep on talking, keep on saying, talk about demand, talk about supply, talk about consumer equilibrium, my God, what we don't talk. And then even when the bell rings and the student says, oh my God, kab jayenge ye? Okay, still we take 5-7 minutes extra. And when it is a sports period or a lunch period, I think they will be after your life, oh my God, sir, just go away right now. But can we actually create a system where we tell students, okay, you take the front seat, you organize a webinar, you talk on this topic. I think we have variety of topics right now in our curriculum where students have to speak. I think you talk about poverty, you talk about infrastructure, you talk about the concept of national income, money banking, budget, you pick any topic. Make them the panelist, make them the finance minister. I still remember during my teaching practice days, way back in 2002, I'm talking about 2002. It was RB Public School, Noida. I still remember. I was a young BEd teacher and I was told to teach. And in 2002, I conducted a press conference with my students way back in 2002. And when my supervisor came and she said, oh my God, how did you actually thought about it? And let me tell you, my class did not go as per my plan. It did not go as per my plan. I failed in that class of in terms of preparing my students for a conference. But let me tell you, teachers, that failure in life will teach you n number of things. So we, as teachers, we should not be afraid of failures. I think we have to keep on trying, experimenting with our students. I think if one time we will not succeed, doesn't matter. I think after that, whenever I've conducted these kind of press conferences inside my classroom, and can you imagine a student sitting in a tie and saying, I'm the finance minister of the country. I'm Chidambaram, Mr. Chidambaram. I am Nirmala Sitharaman. So let us talk about what is going to happen. So I think best learning happens when students will become teacher, and as teacher, we should be listening to it. I think that webinar can easily be conducted if I'm talking about the new strategies of economics, teaching economics in classroom. Now, moving further, I'm going to talk about the school enterprise. I still remember it was 2008-2009, and Dr. Ashok Pandey, he told me that, okay, this is a project coming. So can you do this project, Puneet? And I still remember that during that time, I prepared a team of 4 or 5 students of grade 12, and I was able to collect data of each and every child, each and every teacher of the institution, of my institution. It was somewhere around 2000 students, staff member, and they had the birth date of everyone. And we created an enterprise where we used to surprise someone with a birthday card, and they used to make a birthday card. So say, for example, it's my birthday and they are not going to approach me. They are going to approach my friend. So they were so smart during those time, and they were trained like this. And we conducted this as a small project where data collection was taught to these students, how to gather data, how to gather a person for sales and marketing. How can actually you approach? You talk about 4 P's, you talk about costing, you talk about profit, you talk about n number of things in economics and commerce. All these concepts were actually taught to these students automatically by building a school enterprise inside the school premises. And it was a huge success. The workload of a teacher after setting up the school enterprise, relating every concept of economics with this, actually was a game changer during that time. You talk about producer equilibrium, you talk about cost, you talk about revenue. I think these students were able to understand. And why not? Because the students in future, they are going to get into a job. They are going to set up their own businesses, startups. So why not start up this? I was just going through the news that, okay, Delhi government is starting this. And I was feeling very happy and proud that this is something I've done way back in 2009. And then basically these ideas are now coming up. So I was very proud, and now it has shaped to such a level that these students not only talk about profit, they talk about these sustainable societies, which Samurja was talking about, that they are going to actually earn profit and they are going to donate that profit for a charity or to fund an education of a child or to provide a device or to provide a book or to provide a uniform to a child. I think that is the culture we want in our institution. And I think this is true economics teaching when you talk about something new happening inside your institution. And it is not difficult. I have my counterparts, even few participants who have done this in their institution. They are doing very well. I know them personally. And they have won many awards. But all these enterprises are not linked with awards, but the core skills of the students. Now, I'm going to talk about that because these life skills are very, very important. And I think economics and this school enterprise has taught them. So when you talk about the non-cognitive life skills, you talk about collaboration, they are learning it. And you can easily link it with any of your chapters in economics. So I'm not going to say anything that, okay, you just build up a project and do not connect with your chapter. Please connect it with your chapter. Connect it with economic and social infrastructure, rural development. When you talk about communication, you connect it with consumers, equilibrium, or national income. When you talk about creativity, you connect it with diagrammatic and graphical representation. And I just want to add here, I was talking to my teachers and colleagues in my institution that why there is a need to teach a child that, okay, you prepare a diagrammatic or a graphical presentation on a graphic sheet. Can we move beyond? Can we actually teach a child to actually convert an MS Excel into these graphical presentations? Because in future, will they be presenting to a corporate on a graph sheet, or they will be converting an Excel into a graphical presentation? I think these skills are required by these students. Again, critical thinking, problem solving. I think you give a problem to a student, let them research, let them do whatever they really want to do, and they will come out with a solution. Let me tell you, they will come out with a solution. You give them a task, solve, get a problem solved, and they will come up with some kind of a project. So that can be done. And when you talk about character building, you link it with poverty and unemployment problem. I'm sure students know, I know many people who are here, you have donated food, you have donated, created a culture of library being created in slums. I know few teachers, few people who have done that, donated books. I think character building and human being, the good human being, the good value system we talk about. I think economics is the subject who is going to play a lead role in it. I think if economics teachers can actually start talking about this in their institution, I think the others will actually follow your model of teaching economics. So I'm saying again that these are the five important life skills we all have heard about, but linking it with your chapter in economics and reducing your burden, talking about joy, giving them that learning experience of life, I think that is going to change everything. And that student experience, let me tell you, will be a lifelong experience. They will never forget as to what you did to them when they were in grade 11 and 12, and you gave them this experience. So I think that is the point I want to tell you. I tried this out, that I am very fond of this game, Tambola or Housey. I think every household plays it. Kitty parties cannot happen without this Tambola and Housey. I know that. And yesterday my mother organized a kitty party, so they were also playing. So I remember that when I introduced, I think most of the teachers do it, that why can't we prepare a Tambola or a Housey? And all the numericals, students fear numericals in economics. And you talk to them about national income numericals, and they say, oh my God, please. But when it comes to revision, I've tried in my class, you teach the concept, come for a revision, they will play the Tambola game. Using these concepts, I think they will enjoy it. Today only in our school, incidentally, grade 9 was here, and they were playing this Tambola. Maths department was playing with them, and some prizes were won by those students, and you could see those smiling faces. Means, I think if we put that joy into that learning, our objective is that students should know the concept of national income. They should be able to solve the numerical. That is our objective. But that objective can be met by a traditional method also, that, okay, this is a blackboard, this is a chalk, this is a marker, or okay, this is the formula of GDP and NDP. Otherwise, okay, let us play Tambola today and revise the concept. So it is up to you as to what you can actually do. Now I'm going to talk about something which has actually given me a new idea. When I heard about TED Talks in the beginning, I used to ask myself, okay, can this TED Talks be actually used to teach in a classroom? Can this happen? And because we have organized TEDx in our institution and there are many, many TED Talks available. And in this TED Talk, I really like this young Sarpanch. So I'm going to play a little bit, 3 to 4 minutes, and I'll share this link with everyone. You can completely teach them rural development using this TED video of 18 minutes. Trust me, you don't will have to speak anything about rural development. Every concept of rural development is spoken by this young Sarpanch in this TED Talk. And I'm sure there are hundreds and hundreds of TED Talks available, and students love talking about them. These students, because they themselves organize these kind of things and they attend also, so their connection with these TED speakers is much better as compared to if Puneet Duggal is going to speak about rural development. To be very honest, they are going to listen to them more. So wherever you have resources, I think we can easily and easily make best use of it. So let us watch this video for 2 to 3 minutes, 5 minutes. I'll be sharing that link. And trust me, if you will watch this entire video, your rural development chapter is finished and students will be able to learn in a much better way. So let me share the sound also. Yeah.
क्या लगा आप लोग को कोई बुजुर्ग सा आदमी आएगा गंदे से कुर्ते पजामे पहन के धोती पहन के? खैर गलती नहीं है, मैं भी पहले ऐसे सोचता था, सारे नेता ऐसे होते हैं। तो शुरू करते हैं अपना सफ़र मेरा कि ये सरपंच बनने की मैंने कैसे सोची और कैसे मैं इस फील्ड में आया। वरना मैं भी ये जो सबसे बदमाश बच्चे पीछे बैठे होंगे ना, मैं भी उनमें से एक था। देखिए इस फोटो को आप, 2015 की फोटो है ये, मैं यूनिवर्सिटी में था। अब इसको देख के क्या लगता है क्या बनेगा? कोई कहेगा मॉडल, कोई कहेगा तो कुछ करेगा ही नहीं, कोई कहेगा घर पे बैठेगा, मूवी देखेगा, नेटफ्लिक्स देखेगा, वीडियो गेम खेलेगा। मुझे भी नहीं पता मैं क्या करूँगा अब। चलिए ठीक है, अब हमने सोची सरपंच बनने की। दरअसल मुझे शुरू से ही दो ही चीज़ें करनी थी, या तो मुझे एक यूनिफॉर्म जॉब करनी थी, मतलब क्या लोगों की मदद करेगा ये, क्या गांव में तो भी बहुत होता है ना भाई, बड़े छोटे से बात करने का कि बुजुर्ग है भाई, बुजुर्ग है तो उससे बुजुर्ग की तरह बात करना है, उससे आप फ्रेंड की तरह बात नहीं कर सकते। भले सब लेके नाम लेके बात करते हैं, लेकिन तो आप जॉब मत ढूंढिए, अपनी एक छोटी सी दुकान खोलिए, आप टेलरिंग करिए। उसमें महिलाओं के लिए जैसे कि हाउस होल्ड वर्क्स होते हैं, पापड़ बनाना बहुत नॉर्मल सी बात है, तो वो करिए। तो मैंने उन सबको वो चीज़ें समझाई, धीरे धीरे मैं आगे बढ़ा, लोगों से मिलता रहा, जनसंपर्क करता रहा। अब मैं जीत गया फिर इलेक्शन, ये मेरे इलेक्शन जीतने की फ़ोटोज़ हैं। मैं इलेक्शन जीता, लोगों ने मुझे बहुत प्यार दिया, मुझे भी यकीन नहीं हो रहा था मैं सरपंच बन गया। वैसे मैं आपको बता दूं, आज 4 साल हो गए हैं मेरे सरपंची को। तो मेरे गांव का 0% क्लास 10th का रिजल्ट था। मेरे गांव का स्कूल माध्यमिक विद्यालय है, क्लास 12 तक का है, बट ड्यू टू शॉर्टेज ऑफ टीचर उसमें नहीं है, तो बच्चों को दूसरे स्कूल, मतलब दूसरे गाँव जाना पड़ता है, ऑल द वे 2-3 to 4 kilometers, एंड दे हैव टू वॉक ऑल द वे। तो उसके बाद हमने लड़कियों को, हमारे एक मुस्लिम डोमिनेटेड गांव है, हमारा मुस्लिम बाहुल्य गांव है, तो जैसे कि हमारी कम्युनिटी में लड़कियों को पढ़ाते नहीं है, मतलब कि लड़की है घर का काम करेगी, भैंस का गोबर खाना ये सब वो, बट वो नहीं चलेगा अब, ख़त्म भाई, अब तो पढ़ाना पड़ेगा लड़कियों को। तो हमने धीरे धीरे लड़कियों को पढ़ाना शुरू किया स्कूल में करा हमने। और मैंने स्कूल में, जैसे कि आपने वो मुद्दा सुना होगा कि भाई बेटी बचाओ बेटी पढ़ाओ नारा, अब सरकारी स्कूलों में तो वॉशरूम ही नहीं है, तो भाई बेटी पढ़ेगी कहाँ से? एक बहुत नॉर्मल सा क्वेश्चन है आप, मतलब हम सबके बहन बेटियाँ हैं, अगर किसी स्कूल में या किसी घर में वॉशरूम ना हो तो क्या वो वहाँ जाएंगे? क्योंकि ये तो एक नेसेसिटी है। तो हमने अपने स्कूल में 3 से 4 वॉशरूम बनाए, जिससे कि 300 लड़कियों ने स्कूल में एनरोल किया।
तो what I'm talking about is not something which is not achievable. It is not a difficult task to find a TED talk on internet. And it is not difficult to connect it with your chapter. It is not that difficult, trust me. It is just a matter of maybe investing that time in the beginning. And if you invest, you are convinced that yes, it is going to make my class interesting. It is going to bring smile on the faces of my young learners. I think you are going to do that. So now next is a newspaper can change life of a student. I'm sure every teacher speaks in their classes that yes, please read newspaper, please read newspaper, please read newspaper. No one is going to read, I'm telling you. No one reads. Only out of a batch of 40 students, one or two will read. So what I did, we did as a team at Alcon, was that I bought a spiral, white spiral with white A4 size sheets, and I used to keep it in my office or maybe when I go to class. I used to tell students that please don't read the newspaper. You just cut a cutting of newspaper and just paste here. Don't waste time in reading right now. I know the students are the most busiest people on this planet. They are very busy. So if they have to watch Netflix, they will watch Netflix. They are not going to read your newspaper and they are not going to listen to you also. So the best way is that, okay, you go into a classroom, you have your spiral, just cut it there, have a scissors with you and just paste it. And then maybe wherever you are finding a newspaper and you start cutting it, and then student will start maintaining it. Then you can talk about the newspaper cuttings and then you want to get into that habit. Now, I personally believe that any habit formation cannot take place till the time that habit formation is not with the teacher. If I'm not going to have a spiral with me every time and students are going to laugh at me that, oh my God, see, look at sir, he's carrying that spiral and newspaper, he's cutting down. I think that kind of attitude has to be there if we really want our students to read the newspaper. Otherwise, students will never read a newspaper, trust me. And once you get into this habit formation, I think they will come up to you and they will say, this is not, I'm again saying, this is not something I'm talking about something which is an illusion or something which is a dream. It has happened to me. So I'm saying it with conviction that students started reading newspaper and they have done wonders in terms of reading it. And when you talk about case studies today, now imagine, I'm observing so many authors, so much content is being prepared for case studies. If we actually introduce this habit, be it virtual, do you think that basically case studies are to be taught to students? I think if this habit formation is there, automatically, I think your one part of the question paper will be over, that is case studies. Your students will automatically be prepared for those case studies. Data will be the next big thing. And I think we have that advantage as economics teacher that a lot of data is available to us. And these data fascinate students. A lot of data is available. You search on the net, you talk about a newspaper or a magazine, and it is going to play a very, very big role. I'm sure everyone has heard about the impact of COVID on Indian economy. Now, the number was minus 23.9%, if you remember that number. Now, a question will definitely come from a class that what is this minus 23.9%, sir? The entire world is talking about this GDP growth rate, negative growth rate. I think that data interpretation, how you handle data in your classroom, how you teach your student that what is GDP and how this data is to be used, I think you are going to do a fantastic job if you actually teach your students from day one how to handle data. Now, again, we talked about entire data, but as economics teachers, I think it is our responsibility to tell the story from the beginning. I think we have the opportunity because we have the data. It is easily available on net and websites of many institutions. We can always connect that data with most of your chapters. Now, students fear data in Indian Eco. They are going to always ask you, oh, sir, do I have to remember this? Will it come in board exam? They start playing this with data from day one. I don't need to actually learn data. Why not, basically? Why can't they actually go out any chapter right now? I think data can actually give you the entire picture as to what is happening to the economy. And when you are going to teach in your classroom, I think you can easily connect. And we know with the experience of teaching statistics to young students for so many years, a single numerical data can actually have a bigger impact as compared to a paragraph. So why not use data effectively in our classrooms? And there is so much data available and it can easily be converted with many, many factors. I think this COVID has also given us the opportunity to talk to students in detail about the top five industries which are hit by coronavirus. I think we have discussed this in our classrooms. We have the opportunity in our syllabus and curriculum that, okay, what will be the impact on travel and tourism? What will be the impact on hotels, restaurants, entertainment? They have observed. One day I was talking to the students and the discussion was that there is an app known as Book My Show. I'm sure you have also booked a movie in your life. Now, what Book My Show did during pandemic? So this was the discussion inside the classroom, that what business model was adopted by Book My Show during the COVID time, because cinema halls were shut down. There was no movie booking. So Book My Show is still running. It has not closed down. So there has to be some reason as to what they did. I think these kind of questions, these kind of discussions will prepare these students for life ahead. And I think they will be inquisitive. They will be asking you questions. They will be talking to you. And we'll come out with some kind of an idea generation. And maybe, and the response of one of the students was that, sir, do you know that Book My Show helps you to actually order food also now? Can you imagine? Students are your best teachers. So the message is this. I never knew that, to be honest. But during my classroom, one of my students taught me 4 or 5 different things what Book My Show did during this pandemic time. Is that not a true learning, which we actually want our students to be? And it came out of discussion. It is not something, is this written in any textbook of economics? No, I don't think so. But do you agree that this has to be discussed? This has to be discussed in present scenario. Many of these young students will get into jobs, get into businesses, and that business and job is going to change. They are going to change jobs, I believe, more than 5-6 times in their life ahead. These young students who will graduate in 2022-23, you think that they are going to begin with a career and they're going to retire with that same company? Not at all, not at all. And even when their businesses will fail, who will teach them to handle failure in business? Who will teach them? We talk about mental health issues. We have talked about well-being during pandemic. If my student is strong and they know how to actually build up the business once again, or how to build up that thing again, I think that is the entire thing which I've done. This is a very, very good policy, which again, if you want, I can share this link. Impact of COVID-19 on school education in India and the budgetary implications. Why not discuss this during a budget chapter? Because when you talk about budget issues, I think what is happening to school education, students should also know. The implication should be discussed ultimately. I think within teachers, within departments, a discussion can come out, and where I think you will see the data here, you will see the impact, and then you will realize as to what can be done. Because we talk about learning gaps, we are discussing about that digital divide day in and day out in many, many webinars and seminars. But what are the solution at? What is government of India doing? What are private players doing? Or what is school is doing? What NGO is doing? I think students have all the right to know as to what is the perspective about what is happening right now in the country vis-a-vis this education. Because if a learning gap has been created, the impact of learning gap is not visible or measurable right now. It will have an impact 5 years, 7 years down the line. So I think that also needs to be discussed. Even with students, I think we all have discussed about the measures and the stimulus package being done by the government of India. If we know, we are teaching a concept of recession, we are teaching a concept of deflation to students. So why not we talk about Dr. Nirmala Sitharaman? Why can't we talk about these cuttings which are easily available, that this is the government has done? Have you read today? And can we discuss as to what is to be done? So in terms of giving them, again, that old and outdated approach of few monetary policies and fiscal policies written in the book, why can't you actually, we talk about practically what government of India is doing in terms of giving a stimulus package to solve this problem, solve this slowdown, solve this recession. And then students also become party to it and calculate what impact it is actually bringing to the country. And we can discuss all these solutions, I think, with students. Employment and business. I think students, we should discuss with them that Maruti Suzuki, Mahindra and Mahindra, they were able to manufacture ventilators also. So how you see that how business environment is changing, how things are changing and how companies are changing, because the students will have to reach to a level where students should be taught a lot of flexibility at workplaces, a lot of flexibility in colleges, universities and their employment. AI, artificial intelligence. One student, I was interacting with one student, and she told me something which initially I did not believe. And then she shared a project. It is basically a Government of India project where the vaccination drive to young kids of migrant laborers. So what Government of India is doing using AI is they have prepared a small chip, and that chip they have tied up with a thread in the neck of a small child who is in rural India. The entire vaccination schedule of that particular child can be easily scanned by Government of India. And if that migrant labor moves from one place to another, the vaccination details of that particular child remains, and that data remains with Government of India. Can you think of this kind of a system anywhere? This has been done right in our own country, in rural India. But this information can be brought up when you have a strong alumni connect. We have always and always made connections with our alumni. These students, when they pass out your institution and then you call them and invite them, that okay, today there will be an alumni talk and they are going to talk about what is happening and what has been their experience. So one of my students told me that, sir, do you know this vaccination in rural India is managed with the help of technology and AI? And the migrant labor moving from Uttar Pradesh to Maharashtra to Bihar, the vaccination of child is not going to suffer. So that is, that kind of projects are being done by Government of India. This should be told to the students in grade 11 and 12 only. Because when they will get into these kind of projects in future, I think the way AI is changing our lives, we all know what is going to happen in next 5-7 years. The students, you just search on YouTube or Google something, I think you will get all those advertisements related to what you have searched. You know about how Facebook works or Insta works or what is happening in social media. So I think these students, because they will get into these kind of projects, they will get associated with these kind of corporates, so they should be knowing as to what is happening. And even the problem of malnutrition in our country, we have the systems in place where the nutrition level of a child can also be measured with the help of AI. So these are the two new innovations. Now, here comes the role of a student of science, PCM economics. PCM economics child always will ask you that, sir, can I drop economics and take physical education? They will be after your life. Can we actually convince them that, dear, you have taken sciences, this is your future. You will solve these problems. You will get into big corporates. So you have an added advantage of physics, chemistry, and maths. So please take economics and see, you will change. And we have few of our students and they are placed well because of this combination. So quickly, we teach students about health, and there are chapters in our syllabus. I think human capital formation is there, health infrastructure. We talk about how health is connected with productivity, efficiency. And I think all these issues, linking it with GDP, and then again talking about AI again in the classroom. Now, if CBSC is saying that, okay, your student can take AI maybe from grade 6 onwards, I think these students should also be, I think we cannot teach AI directly to them as economics teacher, but we can expose them to AI. And I think AI is monitoring everything, and it is actually supplementing the efforts of whether it is NGO, government, private players, and health, health infrastructure, productivity, GDP, everything is being managed with the help of technology. I have spoken a lot, and now a time for a quick brain sprint, I'll call. I've taken this terminology from Dr. Ashok Pandey only, that in his one of the session, what all activities can I plan in money and banking? And how should we prepare our students for life? Can I have some answers in the chat box quickly? 1 or 2 minutes, not more than that. If you have to teach money and banking beyond textbooks, there is no textbook, what you will teach them, what activity can you do? You can write in the chat box, maybe a word or a sentence. There are no books in your classroom. There is no NCRT. There is no Sandeep Garg. There is no TR Jain VK Ori, nothing. You are the teacher and you are the book. So teach money and banking with a lot of freedom and from the vision that what a child should know in this chapter when that child will move out of grade 12 and when he will start using in his life money and banking practically. So I am getting responses, and I will ask how much money you should have to donate to the needy or great. Create a bank scene. Students may deposit fake currency. Oh my God. So lot of ideas are coming. Students are instructed to go to bank with parents, making one person RBI, others a commercial bank. I think great activities all of you are suggesting. Financial literacy, great. That how to fill a check, yeah. How to fill your school fee. What is a check? What is account pay? Go to the account section and please pay the fees. I think this is the basic thing. What is a debit card? What is a credit card? Banking at home. How will you submit a school fees? I see one of the teachers, she has already written that. How will you open an account? How to use an app? E-cards. And where will you go if there is a fraud? Your money has been taken out from ATM card and you have that ATM card in your pocket and there is a sudden message, 40,000 have been deducted. Now what to do next? So can textbooks teach that? Can money banking 6 marks in CBSE teach that? We have to prepare our students for life ahead. We are talking about life ahead. And to be very honest, most of the parents, most of the teachers sometimes also do not know that in case there is a fraud which has taken place with me, and ultimately how to go, how to approach, what is to be done. So this cybersecurity awareness is important. You must tell them the value of money. You must talk to them about checks and demand drafts. I think you have ideas. I don't have much to say. I think I'm blessed that the participants here are already aware about all these things. So my work is very, very minimum here. Now coming to the favorite topic, my favorite topic, that is SDG integration. So when Indian Eco came in way back, I think 2 years back, and to be very honest, every teacher was talking about, and oh my God, it will not be scoring, it will not be scoring, it will not be scoring, and macro is there, micro is there, and now 90 will not come, 100 will not come. Everyone was talking about this. But I think when we sat down and we thought that, okay, can we see something positive in it also? So the positive part was that each and every chapter of this Indian Eco is connected to SDGs. Now, I think SDG integration, most of the schools are doing. They have integrated in their curriculum. And the first goal of SDG says end poverty, no poverty. And see, you have poverty as your chapter. Now, what is the best way? I think automatically any subject where in most of the subjects, we need to actually make an effort to integrate SDG with your curriculum. But in economics, there is no need because your chapters are directly linked. If you look at goal number one, you can talk about this in detail with your students, implement plans. They will give you n number of ideas how to end poverty in our country, maybe in their locality, in their districts. You talk about zero hunger. Again, you can easily link your chapter very easily. And SDG goal number three, we all are talking about good health and well-being for the past 17, 18 months. And we have already a chapter in place. Human capital formation is talking about health as a topic. The infrastructure is also talking health about topic. I think it is blessing in disguise. And if someone really wants to integrate SDG with their curriculum, you just open your Indian Eco book and just open this chart of SDGs, these 17 goals, and you can easily link all the goals. It is not difficult at all. And trust me, when you talk with conviction with these students that these SDGs, and I think we all have to work, and pandemic has taught us that these are also now very, very important, and we need to actually achieve those targets and we need to strive for that. I think that becomes very, very important. Now, again, I'm going to talk about government budget. Now, in government budget, our finance minister, Honorable Finance Minister, she talked about these 6 pillars, health and well-being, physical and financial capital during her budget speech, inclusive development and aspirational India, reinvigorating human capital, innovation and research and development, mini government and maximum governance. So finance minister, she gave those 6 pillars. So when you're talking about government budget in your classroom, when you're talking about that data, those government budget figures, you're talking about deficits, allocations, how it is done, and what are the components of budget, n number of things we are talking. I think we all should actually connect the budget speech and these 6 pillars inside, bring it in your classroom. And then how beautifully it has been done, that it is connected to the SDG goals. So these 6 pillars with the SDG goal, I think, connection, you'll be able to achieve your target of government budget also. You can actually give n number of activities to these young students. And how beautifully, I think, it has been done, where each and every six pillar, and these six pillars which were highlighted by Honorable Prime Minister, they have connected it with all these sustainable goals. I think this is the best slide of my presentation, to be very honest. And again, I'll give credit to Sir only for actually bringing this. That, see, this is something, this is a big picture, and where when we have to discuss about government budget, I think students will be able to relate it much better. So question and answer, I think.
There are two questions in the Q&A box, Puniji.
Yeah, so one question I can see is, how can someone re-motivate after facing a failure? I think that you can tell your own experiences. Have we ever not failed in our lives? We have failed. So I think your own experience, and here I think the best pedagogy would be a storytelling technique. There are many, many stories available, and you can have your own story. You can have story of, I think, famous entrepreneurs, businessmen, and we can motivate ourselves. I motivated myself through a TED talk, through a discussion that, yes, I'll have to begin from zero again. So failures will happen. And I think this will be a most important skill in today's time, that how to handle a failure. Students know how to handle 100 marks. They should know how to handle a failure also in life. I think as teachers, we can motivate them very easily.
Puniji, one question I'll ask Ashok sir to answer, but you please answer this Tamanna's question. How can economics be related to art integration? Ashok sir, I request you to please answer the second question. Yeah. The participants has not given the name. How much it is important to make ourselves feel special in any complex situation? I request Ashok sir to please answer it after this Puniji answers about the art integration question.
Okay, let Puneet finish it. Yeah.
So art integration, I think first when this term was coined, I still remember I went downstairs at basement to my music teacher, and I sat with him. And I told him that I want a song on perfect competition market. Can you make a song with me? I sat with him. And then I called 2-3 students of my class that, can you actually help me in lyrics? And we sat down. Although it was not good song, to be very honest. Okay. But we just enjoyed that. I think art integration, when you're talking about economics with art integration, I think even if I remember, I think 2 or 3 years back, I was teaching to a humanities group. And I told them that objectives of government budget, because during that time, if you remember those objectives of government budget, there were big, big paragraphs given. And students used to find it very difficult in terms of recalling or remembering. I told them, can you read this paragraph and convert it into a picture? But in that picture, all the hints of the answer should be there. And they did it beautifully. I think those students have that talent. And I think in every class, if you will talk to the students, music, this art, every student has got their talent. As a teacher, you have to just discuss with them a new idea, and they will be onto it. And they will actually do much more than your imagination. So it can easily be done, I think.
You have beautifully explained how SDG can be connected with, you know, the direct connection is there. The chapter is on poverty. The chapter is on human resources and human capitals. The chapter is, natural resources. So all these, they can be directly connected with SDGs. And children can beautifully design the posters, the placards based on this. So music and dance, definitely a very, very nice concept. You talked about the school enterprise, which is again, a kind of, it can be a case study, it can be the art integration. I remember one of the parameter of that school enterprise was where the marketing manager of the school enterprise, the student marketing manager, had to visit another school and convince them to adopt that school enterprise project. So the children, they were writing script before going to to another school and all this. That is also a part of the art integration. So I think Ashok sir, there is a question. I think the same person has asked two questions, which one Puneet has answered. How can someone re-motivate after facing failure, and how much it is important to make ourselves feel special in any complex situation?
Over to Ashok, sir. So first one, I think Puneet has already answered.
Yeah.
And the second one, let me decode the question first, and then I'll try and answer it in my own limited way. One is complex situation, perhaps the person means difficulties, right? Adversities. And adversities for yourself and maybe for others as well. Now, feeling special has got two facets. One is feeling special with a lot of arrogance, and feeling special with a lot of humility. And therefore, we have to make a choice. I would not recommend to feel special with any amount of arrogance, okay? That is out of place. That doesn't help. In fact, that has the potential to convert even ordinary and favorable situations also into a difficult situation. But if you are special with humility, then the thought that will come to your mind is that I'm capable of doing it. I'm resourceful to handle this problem. I will take help, but I will give my best. And that speciality about you will have a lot of potential to solve the complex situations. I think this is what I can respond at this point of time.
Beautiful, beautiful, wonderful. So thank you, Puneetji. Thank you, Ashok sir, for making another episode of Experion Talk Show. Yes, please. Yes, Puneetji.
Last 2-3 slides before I wind up. I'm going to just talk about the concept of, I think we were talking about assessments and everything. So flexible assessments, I believe that is the need of the hour. And right now we are talking about assessments that, okay, it will be MCQ type, or it will be case study, it will be reasoning assertion. But I think we have some advantage and flexibility in our system, where if we are talking about learning for life, so even the topics, whether it is objectives or government budget, can be give different assessment to different students based on their learning style, where you tell a student to make infographic. You can tell a student to, okay, go through a government budget data and you prepare a government budget for Government of India. Why can't you do that? In one of our holiday homeworks, I discussed with my team that why can't we tag the Prime Minister of our country and make infographics, beautiful infographics, and people around the world, globe, should know as to infographics, how you can actually make. And right now we see that Government of India does a lot of work in terms of infographics. Why can't we tell the Prime Minister of this country or Finance Minister of this country that, okay, this much amount of budget should be allocated for education, and you are just giving us little. That is why there is very difficult to get admission into a good college, because we don't invest so much into education. Can we tell our students to actually use a podcast? So I think different variety of assessments are available. It is not that difficult. It is just a matter that how you plan your assessments and give more and more flexibility. And let me tell you, once you start giving this flexibility to students in terms of assessment, that, okay, you write a blog, you TED Talk, you can talk about a TED Talk. So I think those students will, their happy faces will actually give you all your assessment, rather than that particular red pen and writing 10 out of 20, 15 out of 20, tick mark, cross mark. And trust me, and my final thoughts are that your students will actually love you more, and I can say it with conviction. And all the participants, I think everyone who is sitting here, who was your favorite teacher during your school days? If you remember that person, I think the point I'm making here is, student will never remember you for 100 marks, let me tell you. We have got in our career also 100, 100 and 100, but they will always remember about the experience they got in your classroom, whether it is a virtual experience or an offline experience. They will remember you for that. Okay, there was a teacher who used to enter the classroom with a Maggie packet or a soft drink or a chocolate and used to tell us that, okay, what you're going to eat today, and let us talk about law of diminishing marginal utility with the help of a dairy milk. I think that kind of thought process has to be there. And in the end, we all as team, I think many, many educators sitting here, many teachers, senior people. I think as a team, as a department, we need to sit together. We need to discuss, debate. And then I think I really like this quote. If you want to go fast, you go alone. But if you want to go far, you have to go together. So that is the whole idea of this Samurja and this Education 4.0. That together, I think we will learn. Together, we will fail also. But together, we will celebrate our success also. So thank you. I think this is my email ID. If any further queries are there or some questions are there, I'll be happy to answer. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Wonderful presentation. Wonderful. Everybody is so engaged and so many messages in the chat box. Really, really thoroughly enjoyed your session. It's the time to wrap up now. Ashok sir, a final statement from your end.
How much time you have, Muktaji? I will time up according to that only.
Anybody would love to hear you for hours together.
Nay, we have to respect time also. But anyway, let me begin by complimenting my colleague Puneet. I've been working with him for more than 15, 16 years now. And he's a prolific teacher, let me tell you, very unconventional, risk taker, innovator, you know, collaborator. And all the, you know, the his whole presentation is an evidence of what kind of teacher he is and what kind of teacher one should be, right? So that is about his presentation. And two or three things which I like very much is, one is, of course, a teacher has to be very, very reflective. You know, a teacher has to bring research and data into the classroom, right? And the another thing about, not only about economics, but about all the subjects, that, you know, we have to, you saw, if you remember one of his slides, that, you know, by doing this activity, you learn these many character values, right? But those character values also bring in cognitive values also. And ultimately in life, both are important. And if we have to decide which one is more important, I would put my money on character values, right? Rather than the other one. So I think in your class, lessons, experiences, if you bring this kind of experience, I think that is amazing. Two or three more things were also coming to my mind when I was listening to him. Economics is about earning money, right? And economics, people say, is about benefit. But once you have earned the benefit, what do you do after that, right? So where will you put that money, right? And that is why Mahatma Gandhi said, you know, that this world offers everybody what one needs, but it does not offer you the greed component of it, right? Then he also said that whatever we have, you know, we might have earned it through hard work and this, but at one stage, we all become custodians of it. And that should be put to public use, to public welfare, right? And I think this is the greatest value of economics, in my opinion. Okay. You know, in last year, that is 2020, Economics Nobel Prize was jointly given to two people, Milgram and Wilson. And you know what was the topic for which they were given? Because they have given a new theory of auction. So how to conduct an auction for radio frequency, or it could be for coal mines in India, right? I mean, much infamous or whatever it is. And they have given a new format for that. So on one hand, you have got that extreme, which economists are thinking about. But you go back to 1 year more, and 2019, the Economic Nobel Prize went to Abhijit Banerjee, his wife, Esther, and his colleague, Kremer, three people, right? And you know what was the topic for which they got the Nobel Prize? How to remove global poverty. Okay? So you imagine in 100 years, we have grown 4% in population. So today we stand at 7.5 billion. And in 2050, we'll be 10 billion. And to feed these many people, we have to double up our agricultural production. So I think we have to think about that. And therefore, our classroom discussions, you know, should revolve around that. Okay. I quickly pulled out this book from my bookshelf. You know, this is the book Poor Economics, which is written nobody else but Abhijit and his wife. You see? And I want to tell you, somebody talked about gender equality also in between. And Nasir Khan's TED talk, you heard about girls not being allowed to go to schools. I want to tell you something very interesting. When this couple got the Nobel Prize in 2019, Indian media wrote, Abhijit and his wife got Nobel Prize. And French media wrote, Esther and her husband got the Nobel Prize. Okay, because she's a French lady, right? So anyway, that aside, the point that I'm making is that ultimately, let me tell, I always come back to our ancient wisdom. And let me quote our ancient wisdom, very closely related to economics, which I know both you and Puneet are very fond of. So what is that? Vidya dadati vinayam. Vinya dadati patratam. Patratvam dhanama prapti. And dhana dharma tatah sukham. So your series is sustainability, right? So sustainability means what? Sukham. Tatah sukham. Everybody should be happy, right? That is what you are talking about. So I'm going backward. If everybody has to be happy and has to lead a sustainable life, then everybody in this world should do good things. Dhana, dharma. So you have to do dharma. Dharma, not religious preaching. Dharma means welfare. Good for others. Good for society. And for that, you need dhana. So you have to do dhan prapti also. That is not denied. So you do dhan prapti, but dhan prapti you have to earn and you have to be eligible for that. Okay. So that eligibility will come by developing skills and knowledge and values and education. And that is why it is important, right? So that eligibility will come from humility. That eligibility will come from where? Humility. And that humility should come from education. Okay, so vidya dadati vinaya. So this education should give us humility. Humility should, you know, give us patrata, eligibility. That should give us ability to earn. That should give us wisdom to use it for welfare. And that will bring sustainability. I think economics only has the answer to this. This is what I thought that I will add to this beautiful presentation, right? And therefore, when he talked about the sustainable developmental goals, the poverty, you imagine, I mean, the food production has not reduced in this world, but the hunger is increasing. Why? Poverty is increasing. Why? And if we do not mend our ways and the impending danger of pandemics like this, the climate change driven catastrophes, migration, unrest, tension, you know, the and the marginalized communities, the children. If you add all those, I think we are in the throes of a non-sustainable world. So I think that should become the defining feature of all the education that we do, and we should take care of that. So I think Puneet has brought these elements in his presentation. And thank you very much for giving me opportunity to express my views as well. Thank you, Muktaji.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. Ye shlok Suraj Prakash ji ka favorite shlok tha. Aur wo har time ye wala shlok bolte the. Aur aaj aapke muh se sunke aur bhi zyada acha laga. Aur bahut beautifully aapne usko explain bhi kiya. Without further thing, because we are overshooting time, over to Kriti for the formal vote of thanks, please.
Dr. Hasija nahi hai? Has he left?
Dr. Hasija
agar ho to unke bhi do shabd sunne hum log.
No, he is not there.
Achha, okay, no problem. Please carry on. Yeah.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. I, Kriti Kapoor, on behalf of Samurja Educational Society, would like to thank our key speaker, Mr. Puneet Dugal, sir, for enlightening us with his knowledge. Today's talk show was full of knowledge and gave us deep insights into the topics. And I'll also connect them to some various activities like connect projects, use SDGs goal, podcast or infographics to your lessons. To understand data, you can have a discussion with your students. On national income numericals can be taught and made easy by involving Housie as a class project. Activities like TED Talks can be used to cover up topics. Money and banking can be taught by with various activities like role play or virtual tour. I'm pretty sure, sir, the precious knowledge that you gave us will definitely help us in our classrooms. Also, I would like to thank respected Dr. Ashok Pandey, sir, for taking out time from his busy schedule and enlightening us with the knowledge. I would also like to thank Dr. Mukta Mishra, ma'am, for giving us opportunity to be part of such informative talk shows. I want to thank the team Samurja and Monica, ma'am, who really worked hard to make this talk show a successful one. Also, thank you to all the participants present here for paying your attention and learning. Once again, thank you, everyone. Namaskar.
Thank you.
Namaskar.
Thank you, Kirti. Thank you, Muktaji. Congratulations.
Sir, thank you. Thank you so much.
Congratulations to you also. Thank you, Monica.
Thank you, sir. Thank you,
thank you, sir.
All the best. Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.